bolt thrower, you have the ultimate soundtrack to defeat the enemy. Who's the enemy? Beats me. All I know is that with bolt thrower, I'm gonna be the one that comes out victorious. Bolt thrower discusses different concepts of war, including real-life war through the ages, as well as fantasy war. The fantasy war is often based on the games Warhammer and Warhammer 40,000. But what's great about Bolt Thrower is that their sound is unmistakable when thrown in with other death metal bands, even many years after the fact. It's very riff-based music. Even my cat likes Bolt Thrower! Barry Thompson and Gavin Ward give off sharp sounds of evil with their stringed metalized cannons. Carl Willett's vocal vibrations rupture eardrums with the force of an earthquake. Jo Bench is gnarly because her bass is the foundation of the band. Yeah, it's important for the rhythm section to be the backbone, but her bass lines are heavy as hell while being humble at the same time. Meanwhile, the drummers Andrew Whale, Martin Kearns, and Alex Thomas got the job done without showing off 90 fills in 60 seconds, and they hit the drum heads with what seems to be the force of Odin's mighty hammer, and somehow the drum heads were able to take it. There's just a perfect chemistry between the instruments, and that's what makes Bolt Thrower as heavy as they are. In Battle There Is No Law is the wild card in Bolt Thrower's catalog. You see, they started off as a punk band, heavily influenced by bands such as Discharge and Crass. Then they heard Slayer and they wanted to play metal. On this album, they play crusty death metal with blood splashes of grindcore. It sounds nothing like the rest of their catalog because as they would go, they would use less and less grind elements and eventually become a full-fledged death metal band. Lyrically, it's about nuclear war, weaponry, the human race after Armageddon, you know, typical things that they would talk about. The vocals are a bit quiet, the drums are sloppy, and the production is noisy, but maybe that's the charm that this album has. It has this homemade quality about it, and you can't help but admire the passion that they threw into this thing. Carl's death metal vocals are guttural, but they're the highest register that they would ever be on a Bolt Thrower album. The guitars are down-tuned, and Joe's bass is just laying a pounding in the background. Everything is being pounded to hell, and you feel it. In Battle There Is No Law is a battle, and sounds as such. This thing is so fun to listen to that it could be used to liven up a party!
Hey baby, what's up?
Primarily, there are fast songs on here that still have their slowdowns, but don't expect anything to be as slow as they would be on future albums, such as The Fourth Crusade. What you should expect is heaviness. Lots of it. Forgotten Existence is a highlight, so is Denial of Destiny and Attack in the Aftermath, which would be the beginning to many crescendoing drum intros. This crescendoing drum intro would end up being a staple among several Bolt Thrower songs in the future. A recurring theme, if you will. Some of the songs sound a bit similar, but you have songs such as the title track, Nuclear Annihilation, and Attack in the Aftermath, which have lives of their own. The songs are bastards to listen to by themselves, but In Battle There Is No Law is best heard as a whole. There are lots of guitar solos, lots of heavy palm muting, and catchy riffs. Sometimes it sounds like a mishmash, but maybe that's what I love about it. I'm not dressed for Bolt Thrower. I love the smell of metal in the morning. The band's second album, Realm of Chaos, Slaves to Darkness, there's an intro of evil. And then, there's Eternal War. The guitars are tuned to A, so you might think that you're in the Sludge and Fuck Factory. However, that only adds to the heaviness. See, the song goes through several different changes. At first, it's crustier than a dinosaur's balls. Then comes the blast beats. Then come the danceable parts. With this album, there's a constant attack of doom. You're in the battlefield of your life. There are some grindcore hints throughout the album, but ultimately, it's a death metal album. The crazy guitar solos alone are enough to get Godzilla to turn his head. It seems like everybody's playing at a low register. The bass is rumbly, the guitars are extremely down-tuned, even the drums sound low. Imagine the sound of turning the speed on the record player down a little bit. With this album, the slight sloppiness is still there, but it makes things better. See, Balthur wasn't known to use a metronome, so you'll have the occasional slight sloppiness in the drums and occasional odd timing, but that makes things sound more natural and more human. The guitars are dark and soily, and the drums sound huge. On the full dynamic range reissue, the bass is more pronounced and the sound is cleaned up a bit. Unfortunately, though, the copyright problems with the artwork makes everybody feel really, really depressed. In the 1980s, Games Workshop, known for the Warhammer games, was a small company that existed only a short walk away from Earache. After seeing a benefit in allowing Balthur to use the iconic artwork from their game, a contract was signed allowing permission to use it for 13 years. Earache went to renew the deal once it expired, and Games Workshop flatly refused. With the initial artwork not an option at the time, a new artwork was made. John Sebeck, who did the original artwork, agreed to remake the album cover with a similar theme and style without the copyrighted elements owned by Games Workshop. Though it's great work from Sebeck, many fans still prefer the original artwork. It just goes to show that when a company becomes hostile, everyone around them suffers. This is definitely one of the faster and heavier Balthur albums. Plus, it has the most blast beats that they would ever use. The groove of the guitar riffs and the drums are probably the most memorable aspect here. Sure, it's extremely heavy death metal, but it's also catchy too. You're gonna find that this massive energy comes from the album. It's very raw, and in the end, lots of objects around you will be smashed. Slow parts, fast parts, it doesn't matter. It's one of those few albums that is designed to get you moving. There are lyrics about mankind and the future of the world, and meanwhile, everything trapped inside the waveforms of this wax wants to hurt you. The power of Lost Soul's domain, the pain of Plague Bearer, and the memorability of World Eater makes Realm of Chaos Slaves to Darkness a landmark in death metal history. In 1991, Balthur released their third album, Warmaster. Holy fucking cock on cunty titties, look at that artwork! You know, death metal has its most iconic artworks, Mental Funeral, Leprosy, Left Hand Path, Butchered at Birth. Well, this belongs right up there with all of them. This is the final album by Balthrower to feature blast beats. It's also Balthrower's answer to the question, what is death metal all about? Everybody's playing abilities have improved, the sound is tighter, the solos are crazier, and there are more melodies.
This is also the first album where the guitars are tuned to C sharp, so the notes are more coherent and evil while retaining the heaviness. Any grind elements from the first two shredders are virtually non-existent here, making Warmaster a full-fledged death metal album. There's a lyrical improvement because the songs tell stories this time, but the songwriting also went up a notch. Everything's more dynamic, and there's a bigger impact when the band slows down.
Wow. Thanks for the input, dude. Something you might notice is that some of the songs on here sound very similar. Balthur was kind of the AC/DC of death metal in this way. However, it would be a disservice to them to just say that some of the songs sound the same. If you listen to some of the albums separately, you might notice a recurring theme within them. Sometimes the songs use the same formula, but they mix and match different elements. With Balthrower, it's not just about how brutal they can be, but it's about the style. And their style is to chop your head off with a sword and then blow you up with a cannon, the guitar strings being the fuse. There's a song on here, Destructive Infinity. Well, Warmaster is so destructive that I wish it could go on for infinity. Unleash Upon Mankind, yeah, that's the case with this album. Mankind was just not ready. And who can forget Cenotaph? It's the spiritual successor to World Eater. Again, a recurring theme between songs. Okay, now I'm so pumped that I want to destroy something. You know, these lyrics are always talking about being stronger than your opponent. Well, I gotta find out who that opponent is. And destroy them. You know, whoever it is that I'm supposed to be going after, they're doing a damn good job hiding from me.
The band's fourth summoning of mosh pits, cleverly and chronologically titled The Fourth Crusade, is a welcome change in style. Before I get to the music, I have to mention the brilliant artwork. It has this majestic but old-fashioned quality to it. It could fit practically any doom metal album. Everything is slower, taking on more of a doom metal influence. Even the guitar solos are slower and more melodic. The general slowdown causes the music to be heavier. This way you can appreciate the incredibly heavy guitar tone while being able to hear Carl Willits at 110%. With the music not being so fast, he's able to have more time to breathe. That way he can belt it out even more. On the Fourth Crusade, the songwriting is more cohesive. I often find myself not even noticing when the tempo speeds up or slows down. Generally, the ride cymbal gets a lot of use here too, so the atmosphere is a bit more relaxed. The songs are longer and a little more repetitive, so you have a chance to get in touch with the brooding atmosphere. It's an album where I prefer to be doing things while listening to it, usually evil things. The Fourth Crusade isn't as crazy as the earlier albums, but it doesn't need to be. It's a damn good time. My personal highlights from here are As the World Burns, Dying Creed, and This Time It's War. Tank tracks. The enemy is committing tank crimes, and not the good kind. I've got them now, I'm on their trail! Four Victory is the bolt thrower album where any newcomer can pick it up and get into it easily. The nice melodies of the Fourth Crusade and the brutality of Warmaster are carried over, but in a more desolate way. Not a lot of new territories explored on this album, so the focus is in the great production and playing ability. Bolt Thrower is 100% on the spot here, and our war theme is of a more modern context. The Speed and Chaos is back with a vengeance. There's a lot of double kick action and the guitar playing is flashier. However, the solos take a back seat, so there's more emphasis on the groove and rhythm in the riffs. We have a nice dual guitar attack on Lest We Forget, Hell on Earth with Armageddon Bound, and Pure Badassery with Remembrance. Four Victory is a highlight in Bolt Thrower's catalog. However, the chain of events after the album was a disaster. The Four Victory tour had to be aborted early, as well as their record contract with Earache. Guess what else? Andrew Whale and Carl Willits both left the band. Pestilence and his fixed throat ripper Martin Van Drunen took over vocals for a couple of years, only to leave before the next album had to be recorded. So Carl temporarily rejoined, and the band went straight into the studio. Mercenary would be the result of this. It's a wonder this album came at all. It came at a time of great turmoil for the band. Mercenary has a bit more variety between the songs, which are slower this time. Generally, the guitars are more melodic. Sometimes the songs stop to build up again, usually using a badass riff, only to have the drums joining in a measure later. Drummer Alex Thomas provides a bit more variety with the speeds. He's probably a bit more outgoing than the band is used to, but at least he's interesting. Though it doesn't sound as if he's on the same page with the band most of the time. The same could probably be said about Carl Willits, who sounds as if he isn't familiar enough with the material to growl the lyrics with compassion. Mercenary is not a bad album. It's just one of the more repetitive and less memorable Bolt Thrower albums. It's basically Bolt Thrower on autopilot. You still have memorable songs such as Powder Burns, Laid to Waste, and No Guts, No Glory, with its cannon fire. The battle must continue. Hope is not lost, but I have to strategize. By doing this, I will gain three things.
Honor, Valor, Pride. The primary thing with this album is that Dave Ingram of Benediction is the singer, and this is also one of two albums where Martin Kearns is the drummer. See, Kearns' drumming is more spirited than his predecessor's, but it fits the music flawlessly. Even though he only played on two Bolthrower albums, he did tour a lot with the band, so people became more familiar seeing him behind the kit rather than anybody else, and many would agree that he was the band's best drummer. Dave Ingram has a deeper growl, though not as projected. His voice is more passive and doesn't have a lot of sustain, but it fits with the atmosphere. However, the chemistry within the music sounds a bit off without Carl Willits as Bolthrower singer. Dave Ingram used these short, deep grunts that probably weren't as powerful as Bolthrower needed. Given the occasional cracks shown, he was probably as good of a replacement as the band would have gotten at the time. The band sounds more comfortable playing together and it feels more natural than Mercenary. Musically, it's slightly more complex, even though there aren't as many guitar solos. Plus, the crisp production makes everything sound meaner. Other than that, it's the same old Bolthrower. Personal highlights are K-Machine, Suspect Hostile, and Inside the Wire. It looks as if I've been trailing behind enemy lines. Judging by their pattern of travel, they're heading towards the trenches. If I could just launch a 7th offensive, completely ignoring the non-existent first 6, I can probably intercept them if I'm fast enough. I can remain entrenched until the enemy comes along. And then... surprise, cockers! This is it. I am Armageddon bound. Bolthrower's 8th and final offering, Those Once Loyal. Just from hearing the first song, At First Light, you should know that you're in for something truly special from the band. Dave Ingram was having medical problems, so Carl Willits is back in the game. The songwriting formula has been up to notch, and somehow the songs sound fresher. Lyrically, the album is mostly about World War I, so you can just picture the 18-pounders, hand grenades, and army tanks just by listening to the music. The style is exactly the same, but the sound and everybody's playing is tighter than ever. Everybody in the band has their chance to shine. Plus, the riffs are more dramatic, so the whole album has this impending climactic nature. Every song on the album shines, though I'll say that I personally prefer the faster songs. Entrenched is catchy and memorable. The Kill Chain is a hard hitter. Anti-Tank, Dead Armor? 3 words. Joe fucking Bench. Last Stand of Humanity has killer drum fills, courtesy of Kitty Kearns. When Cannons Fade has a great drum outro and ends with the vision of walking off the battlefield after you've fucked up your enemy successfully. Ha 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 ha. Then the bonus track, A Symbol of 8. It has riffs that sound like they came from the For Victory sessions. As incredible as it would have been to have a follow-up, this was Bolthrower's final album. The band didn't want to release another album unless it was on par with or better than Those Once Loyal. The band always said that they would stop after they felt like they released the perfect Bolthrower album, so this was their stopping place. The mighty Bolthrower has left their mark on death metal forever. They've influenced countless bands with their style and their simplicity. Any album you listen to will make you want to pick up a sword and fight. I know that when I listen to them, I become the War Master. I knew it! My enemy is a single tank. One war machine against one of me. The odds are looking pretty good. Death by metal. For victory.